After the death of Nero, Rome experienced a civil war for the first time in a century. It was a bit complicated, so here's the gist. A general named Galba came from Spain and took over from Nero in June of 68, but he didn't pay the German legions, so they went into revolt under a general named Vitellius. Galba named some random guy as his successor, but another prominent noble named Otho was mad about this and bribed the Praetorian Guard, which killed Galba in January of 69 and made him the new emperor in Rome. In March, Vitellius' veteran German legions marched into Italy and destroyed Otho in some battles, making him commit suicide. After a few months, Vespasian came with legions from the east and defeated Vitellius, becoming emperor in December. This period is known as the Year of the Four Emperors because four emperors reigned within 1 year. After this chaos, things settled down quite a bit. Vespasian was an experienced general and proved fit to rule with stability and moderation. As a new man taking over from the collapse of the Julio-Claudian dynasty, he needed to establish legitimacy, and he did this primarily by giving gifts to the soldiers and the people, winning them over. Vespasian was also great with propaganda. During his reign, he was meticulous with crafting his public image. He commissioned historians to write favorably about him, portrayed himself as semi-divine on his coins, erased references to rebellious generals or political enemies, and punished those who spoke out against him. Because of this inherent bias in the source material, it is difficult to judge Vespasian's reign objectively, which is exactly what he intended. Vespasian commissioned several building projects in the city of Rome. The city was still damaged from the Great Fire a few years earlier, and he took personal initiative in rebuilding and improving still devastated sections of the city. He also fought against corruption in the law courts, helping to smooth the legal process in important cases. He sponsored campaigns in Britain, which pushed the borders of the empire into modern Scotland. Vespasian was the first emperor from the equestrian class, the class below the senators. He only became a senator later in life after acquiring personal wealth. With this in mind, he made efforts to reform the equestrian and senatorial orders. He purged those of disrepute and added those whom he judged to be deserving. Many of these new appointments were provincial elites, increasing the representation of the provinces within Roman government and society. Overall, the orders became larger and more inclusive. He also expanded the privileges of the equestrians and curtailed those of the senators, bringing the two orders closer together. Vespasian played a crucial role in expanding not just the borders, but the idea of Rome. Vespasian died on the 24th of June, 79, after suffering an onset of bowel illness. He was 69 years old and had ruled Rome for 9 years. Surrounded by his friends, in the throes of death, he rose to his feet, stating that an emperor should die on his feet. Before he fainted, he muttered ironically, "Oh dear, I think I'm becoming a god." Titus was Vespasian's biological son. He had always been his father's trusted lieutenant. When the two fought against the great Jewish revolt in Judea during the 60s, Titus was the second in command, and stayed in Judea when Vespasian marched to Italy. In Judea, he oversaw the sacking and final destruction of Jerusalem in 70, including the infamous destruction of the Second Temple and the diaspora of the Jews across Europe. In Judeo-Christian history, this is now seen as a great atrocity. But at the time, Titus and Vespasian won great praise and glory for their prosecution of this war, celebrating a triumph back in Rome. When Vespasian died, Titus was well suited to take over. He was a mature man of 40 years old and had experience in positions of power. He was hailed by the people, the Senate, and the army. Optimism was in the air for Titus's long and healthy reign. Titus did everything right. He continued the policies of his father, presenting himself as the public face of the imperial regime and sponsoring public games. Worries about his immodesty or cruelty turned out to be unfounded. When disaster struck Pompeii and other towns in the form of Mount Vesuvius, Titus was first on the scene, personally assisting in relief efforts and sponsoring the relocation of the disaster survivors. He was so kind and helpful that reportedly, upon realizing at a late dinner that he had helped no one that day, he remarked, "Friends, I have wasted a day." Unfortunately, he died just 2 years into his reign. He experienced a quick onset of fever, weakness, and then swiftly died at 42 years old. This was a shock to everyone. He had no biological children, meaning the new emperor was to be his brother. The mission has been misjudged. He had a bad childhood. He was 12 years younger than his brother Titus, and by the time he was entering school, Titus was already excelling in public office and serving as his father's right-hand man. Vespasian was hardly ever at home to take care of him throughout his childhood, as he was off on military campaigns with his brother. Domitian always found himself the neglected child, lacking a father figure. Titus was supposed to reign after Vespasian for decades, and Domitian was never supposed to have a chance at the throne, so he was given no real responsibility or experience in administration. Reportedly, he was so angry at his position in life that he plotted several times against Titus's life. Titus himself loved his brother and tried to give him some role in the administration, and he was very troubled by Domitian's actions, which were indicative of an insecure and desperate man. Much of what Domitian did can be seen through the lens of his inferiority complex and desire to prove himself that originated early in childhood. Like previous emperors, he was an authoritarian ruler, curbing and often ignoring the power of the Senate, and making all the decisions himself. One can see how Domitian wanted to compensate for his marginalization earlier in life. Domitian, despite having little experience with administration of any sort, was remarkably competent and diligent. He oversaw every aspect of the imperial bureaucracy, cracking down on corruption and improving the reputation of Rome in the provinces. He also personally reviewed important legislation and refused to appoint family members or sell political positions as Vespasian and Titus had. Domitian traveled the provinces personally to build rapport with the provincials and oversee military affairs. He was particularly popular with the military because he fraternized with the soldiers and personally led military campaigns. His primary focus was on defensive campaigns, which he prosecuted successfully, although his attitude was met with accusations of cowardice. For example, he ordered a withdrawal from northern Britain. It was unproductive land that would have been difficult to maintain. He campaigned against the Kingdom of Dacia, eventually making peace and paying the king Decebalus a small indemnity. He also launched a short campaign against the Germanic Chadai tribe, for which he celebrated a mock triumph. This was probably because he had always wanted the military glory his father and brother had. Domitian continued the taxes of Vespasian and Titus while simultaneously commissioning further building projects in Rome. There had been another fire in 80, and he rebuilt much of the city in grander, more opulent form. He improved the Colosseum, completed the Arch of Titus, redecorated the Temple of Jupiter with a golden roof, and added to the palace complexes sprawling over the Palatine Hill with his own Flavian Palace. He increased the purity of the coinage once again, preferring to mint higher quality coins and ensure economic stability. Despite his lavish spending, he was fiscally responsible and left the empire with a solid surplus of wealth. Domitian was more generous to the people than any emperor since Caligula. He took sponsorship of public entertainment to a new level. The Capitoline Games, intended to be a Roman equivalent to the Olympic Games, were created under Domitian. Assembling a wide variety of talent in athletic contests, poetry, oratory, music, and stage performance. These games brought thousands of the Roman Empire's best and brightest to the city of Rome every 4 years. Domitian's reign was intended to be a cultural renaissance in the mold of Augustus's reign. Accompanying this Augustan renaissance was Domitian's mastery of propaganda that came close to matching Augustus himself. He minted millions of high-quality coins bearing his likeness and depicting him as a quasi-god. He encouraged the development of the imperial cult, commissioning places of worship for people to pay respects to other dead members of the imperial family. And above all, he fostered his own cult of personality, going even beyond Augustus and taking on the role of a god emperor. Unfortunately, Domitian's Augustan revival was missing one crucial piece: humility and respect for the Senate. He was callous with the senators, and combined with his paranoia, it resulted in strict persecutions of senators accused of sedition. He loathed senatorial arrogance. But he was also a hypocrite. I mean, in his presentation as a god emperor, who else was more arrogant? As often happens, his fear of conspiracies led to the development of conspiracies. The legions of Germany rebelled in 89 under the governor Suetonius. This was an isolated incident, and Domitian still had the support of most of the military, but it indicated what would come later on. In 96, his arrogance toward the Senate finally caught up with him. He would find out that he was no god. A courtier arranged a private meeting with him to show him a document. While Domitian was reading, the courtier pulled out a dagger and stabbed him in the groin. Domitian fought back, but he was overwhelmed by several other assassins rushing into the room with knives. He bled out and died on the floor. He was 44 years old and had ruled Rome for 15 years. With him, the Flavian Dynasty came to an end. A dynasty born out of civil war, lasting only a generation before dying out. It was a transitional period defined by conflicting personalities, a redefinition of Roman identity, and petty family drama. Together, these three emperors set the stage for a century of Roman glory.
Okay, she giving me love. What the fuck my energy up? Every time it's finna be something.